This is ArtSense, a podcast focused on educating and informing listeners about the past, present, and future of art. I'm Craig Gould. On today's episode, I speak with Flavin Judd, artistic director of the Judd Foundation and son of the late artist Donald Judd. Donald Judd passed away nearly 30 years ago, but his presence still looms over the art world today through his writings, his artwork, in the spaces he created as permanent homes for his work. It was Judd who brought the art world to Marfa in the early 1970s, triggering a cultural transformation of the West Texas town. The conversation takes a look at the artist's origins, his philosophies, the stressful early days of the foundation, and the show of Donald Judd work on display now through July 14th at Gagosian's Madison Avenue locations in New York. And now, a conversation about one man's pursuit of truth through art, with Flavin Judd. Flavin Judd, thank you very much for joining me this week on the ArtSense podcast. Flavin, I wanted to speak with you. I know there's currently an exhibit of work up at Gagosian's Madison Avenue locations through July 14th that covers a period from like 1965 to 1991, which is a great big swath of your father's work. For those who aren't as aware of who Donald Judd was, which, you know, it's hard to imagine at this point, where do you usually start to describe to them what his work consisted of?
I mean, a kind of short history would be that Don started out as a completely conventional painter. Within the foundation, we have drawings that look like something out of the Renaissance from when he was very young. And he spent about 12 to 15 years doing abstract painting, which were kind of in between representational art and what he wound up doing. And those paintings were things that he was struggling with, because he realized that what he was interested in, which was a kind of factual truth in the way things are and the way things are seen, could not be dealt with in the paintings. That the paintings were, no matter what, were a representation of either ideas, abstract ideas, generalizations, or in some earlier cases, abstractions of actual, you know, like New York bridges and things like that. And so all of that was very was a dissatisfaction for him. And he had to move into three-dimensional space to deal with what he wanted to deal with. And it was an exploration. So his later work, like you see at the Gagosian show, is him dealing in space and color, almost like a scientist would deal with those things. And he was trying to get away from any kind of illusion or representation, and to deal with facts on the ground as they were. To use the response of Johnson to Bishop Berkeley, who knocked on the table, kicked the table with his shoe when told about Berkeley's solipsistic kind of everything is imaginary. Don was trying to deal with the here and now, and he couldn't do that with painting, so he made artworks that exist completely in the here and now.
Wow, so it's really a transition from the illusion to a pursuit of truth, right?
Truth in the sense that it's truth that you, wherever you are, that's where you are, and that's what you know exists. And if you really pay attention to where you are at any given time, it's almost an infinite amount of information you could really take into and explore if you really tried. So, you know, the fact that we are here on this planet is as basically as miraculous as anything could ever be. And the funny thing is that we don't pay attention to that actual thing. We invent things to escape into and draw paintings or paintings of trees and spend a lot of time doing it when the tree itself is absolutely fascinating and it's maybe, you know, worth spending time to actually look at the tree.
What was your father's identity? Because I know that, you know, he wrote somewhere in the range of like 500 reviews in the late 50s and early 60s. And so he was an art critic. Writing was something he continued to do throughout his life. How did he perceive himself? Did he see himself as an art critic that needed to put these ideas in practice to create this truth? Or did he see himself as an artist who just liked to give his opinions and set the record straight?
I mean, if you can say that he saw himself as X, you would say he saw himself as an artist. And as he says, the writing was purely mercenary in the 60s. It was a way of getting a job that allowed him to explore what other people were doing at the same time as paying the rent, which at that time was hard for him to do. Because before that, he was working in a art supply store, which, you know, okay, you learn stuff in an art supply store, but maybe being an art critic is better. And in fact, from the writings, you can see that he was learning a lot while seeing what everybody else was doing. And this was a very, very good time for radical art. It was the beginning of so-called pop art and other things that were very diverse. And for instance, at the time, Yayoi Kusama lived below him on 19th Street. So he was not exactly a super social person. So to be a critic was to get into the art world that he didn't necessarily like. So no, he saw himself very much as an artist, but also he saw no reason to define himself one way or another. He just did what he felt was interesting.
Do you think the writing was a way for him to engage this larger public of the art world without having to have these one-on-one conversations, a way for him to have a presence and be seen without necessarily having to do all of the typical schmoozing that goes with trying to get a leg up?
Well, the art world was very small then. So I mean, if you wanted to schmooze, you could probably do it all in 1 week. I really think it was just about paying the rent and seeing other artists, because that's what he was really wanted to do, was figure out what other people were doing. And you can see from the reviews, he's very quick to dismiss people who are, for instance, you know, doing some stuff that was already 30 years old at that point. He's clearly not going to learn anything from it. So he's like, you know, this is not worth seeing. Next review. So no, I don't think it made him very popular. So that certainly wasn't the goal.
Sure.
And again, he was interested in engaging the public at all. It was just about him thinking and him figuring stuff out.
What cross-pollination were we seeing there on the Lower East Side? I know there are names like Frank Stella, Lee Botenko. Who was your father rubbing up against, and how did these people coexist and share ideas?
Yeah, I think that Lower Manhattan at that time was incredibly vibrant. You had the whole Cointus Slip community, amongst others, and and the ideas were very different. I mean, Bontecou and Kusama and Chamberlain and Stella are all doing completely different things, but they're all actually equally as radical. And for instance, to go to the specific objects essay, which was, as Don has pointed out, was not about his work. It was about other people's work. And it was explaining that people were doing things that were not sculpture and were not painting. And that was interesting because before that, you know, you had the abstract expressionists who kept those two categories pretty clear. And so the mixing of those categories and the mixing of all this other stuff was really interesting. And it was, again, the art world was really small. You could meet everybody within like three parties. So, and everybody lived within blocks of each other, basically. And so I think it was an extremely vibrant community. And obviously, there were lots of disagreements. And out of the disagreements about art came these kind of dissatisfaction engines that pushed all the artists forward. I mean, you couldn't just sit around and be happy with yourself. Certainly somebody would come along and say, hey, so-and-so did that 20 years ago. Why are you doing that? Just out of curiosity. So that makes for a very vibrant scene.
When your father put his money where his mouth was and, you know, moved from the page to the space, what philosophies were at the heart of his work? What was it? Measure, proportion, symmetry? What were the things that he was really sort of obsessed with?
Don had a degree in philosophy and studied a lot of it, but he clearly had a somehow limited philosophical education, because I once asked him if he had studied Immanuel Kant, and he said no. So I'm not sure what he studied, but it wasn't the whole breadth. But he knew, for instance, and really liked the Scottish empiricists like Hume. And I think that and some other things were the things he agreed with and the things he felt comfortable with. And if you read, Western philosophy, you have a lot of language about concepts, but concepts are imaginary. So you have language and arguments about concepts that are imaginary as if they're not imaginary. And the whole argument reifies the concepts and it gets you nowhere. And I think Don was really interested in an art that that's existed first and foremost. And from that premise, he had the ability to play with space and color without resorting to illusionism. And that was kind of the basic bottom level requirement, that it not represent anything else. And if you have something that doesn't represent anything else, it's going to be rather simple. And you're going to have to slowly build complexity into the system as you develop it. And I think that's evident in Don's art, where he went to having one thing on the floor, to having multiple units, to having different colors, different materials. But of course, he always had his own rules about how to do these things, because if you're building something from scratch like he is, you're going to have to build in rules to keep it from getting out of control and to keep it consistent with the original premise.
I wonder if there was any Eastern philosophy in what he studied, because, I've heard you speak before about the necessary space around the objects and how these objects have a particular resonance, and if they're too close together, there's like this dissonance, and it reminds me of like Japanese Zen gardens, right? And I wonder if that was something that he identified with or had thought of in a visual way.
I think he knew something about it, because there are books on all of those things in our library. And for instance, we have a Shingon banner from Japan, I think 16th century, I don't remember exactly now, maybe 17th century, hanging in Spring Street, that he bought in the 50s when he was a student. And also he wrote quite a few papers in college on pre-Columbian art in South America. So he's very interested in all cultures and the way people do things and the way space is used, and the way cultures uses the wrong word, but and manipulate is the wrong word, but the way that cultures adapt and play with space and color. And I don't think he had necessarily an affinity for any one system. I think they were all kind of interesting, but he could certainly learn things from different cultural systems. But I think he didn't identify with any of them, because for him, he was building one of his own, and one of his own that was contrary to the American system of, you know, strip malls and consumerism. And if that system he's building has affinity to, you know, Japanese Zen gardens, I don't think he would have a problem with that at all.
When we think of the spaces that he created, there's 101 Spring Street there in Soho, and obviously Marfa and Chinati. Your father kind of saw himself as a bit of an architect and was kind of critical of museums. You know, was that part of his motivation to create these legacy spaces, a way to control the environment that his work was going to be seen in?
Well, when you're a young artist, I think you accept the structure that you see of the art world. You accept that there are galleries to deal with the commercial side. You accept that there are museums to deal with the so-called cultural side. And then I think this is true in Don's, definitely true in Don's case. But I think in general, as you grow older, you realize that the galleries are basically a money laundering scheme for billionaires. The museums are colonialist trophy houses for empires. And maybe you don't want to be a part of that, you know? And also you realize that if you're an artist and the art is your priority, you realize that it's not the priority for the museums who are making money, and for the galleries. It's the art is not a priority for the galleries whose priority is making money. And it's not a priority for the museums who are basically reputation laundering. So if you want to have the art as your priority, you have to make your own house for it, basically. And that's what Don was doing. And I think he would have been perfectly happy to have other people do it if they showed the care that he thought was necessary for the art, but that was consistently not the case. And even, I mean, I don't really consider myself in the art world by choice. It's by mistake. And everything he says about galleries and museums is pretty much personally confirmed on my side. So he's not at all wrong. And the older I get, the more right he was about museums and galleries. It's like not at all an exaggeration.
I went to college in Dallas, and I remember my painting professor took us to an opening for an exhibit of your father's in 1989. And, you know, I got to hear his talk. I remember being a really amazing show, almost comparable to what I feel like was put together by MoMA a couple years ago. One of the things I really enjoyed interacting with was the stacked plexiglass boxes. And, you know, it just struck me the way it was lit, how the shadows were as much a piece of the work as the object was. But I've heard you say before that he didn't give a lot of concern to lighting in the show because it was really about the object. And he didn't want the lighting to be some sort of theatrical trope. Is that just in terms of these museum installations? You know, because I feel like light's a big part of what is going on in the works at Marfa and in other spaces. I mean, what was his attitude towards light and shadow and his philosophy about it being part of the form?
At the Judd Foundation, we don't have any lights in the exhibition spaces. It's all lit by daylight. A lot of the buildings are old, and so they have lights, you know, to work or, you know, to clean art. But for looking at the artwork, there are no lights. And that's part of the problem of a lot of museum design, is that it's simply not well done and relies on artificial light, which for Don was an imposition, because the ability to see how the light changes the artwork and how the artwork changes the light throughout the day is part of an experience of something. Light is constantly changing, and it's fascinating. And why would you give that up, give it away, to have a tungsten bulb aimed smack at one artwork, as if it were a theatrical play, which is exactly what Don is trying to get away from. So it's not only is it a ridiculous theatrical kind of situation, but you've lost the ability to see how the artwork and the light are intertwining, and that's like something you've lost. So it's not a plus.
I had a conversation with Kate Rothko-Prizel and Christopher Rothko about, you know, kind of maintaining their father's legacy. And one of the things Christopher recounted was helping set up these exhibits at museums and constantly being in battle with the museum to turn the lights down. His father really preferred for these works to be shown in what would be considered a lower light space. And it was just constantly a battle, right?
Well, yeah, because normally, not in all cases, but normally, I think the model for galleries and museums is a car dealership. I think that's basically where they get all their information. You have shiny objects, you want to light them well. And in one way or another, even if you're a museum, you're selling them. You're selling the reputations, you're selling the artist's reputation, or if you're a gallery, you're selling the actual objects. But in either case, you're out to sell something. And if you're an artist, you have no interest in that. That's not your priority. And that's where these two things conflict.
Flavin, you and your sister Rainer were in your mid-20s when your father passed, and I understand the foundation had a number of challenges facing it after your father's passing, and beyond the obvious emotional toll, can you talk about some of the pressing issues you had to confront in that period of transition?
Well, he died rather young. He died when he was 65. And of course, you know, there was a will, but there was no other kind of preparation for this, this event. And when he got cancer, he died. I mean, it was diagnosed in December. He died in February. So that was not a lot of time to do anything. You know, you're basically just trying to like deal with doctors and their euphemisms. When he finally died, we basically had $200 in the bank account. We had over $10 million worth of debt, and we had around 50 employees, none of whom we could pay. And the art world had crashed two years earlier. So we were faced with a situation, but we knew what Don wanted. That was very clear. He wanted the spaces preserved. He wanted the art preserved, and for as long as possible. So given such a simple request, Rainer and I felt it was our obligation to at least try to fulfill the request. We had no idea how. When Don was alive, I thought, yes, oh, there will be a foundation, which is something. And there will be lawyers who will take care of it. But of course, when he died, I realized the lawyers didn't know anything about except how to set up a foundation. That's all they were good for. So we decided we had to try to fulfill the request. And if we failed, we failed. But at least we would have tried. And actually, that's what we're still trying to do. So it just hasn't stopped.
No, and it's a conversation that's come up several times on the podcast. I had the family of Anthony Tapias, you know, on the podcast. Tapias had actually, like your father, had set up a physical space, set up a foundation, you know, during his lifetime. I've had another artist, Glenn Brown, who's in his late 50s, who is in the process of sort of doing the same thing. And from your perspective, you know, what advice would you give an artist that's establishing their own foundation and museum while they're still alive? I mean, would it be to encourage better archiving, conservation, deaccessioning guidelines? Like, what? Not that, you know, we can go back and change what your father's plans were, but what advice would you give an artist who's, you know, getting to that point in their life where they want to make sure that their legacy is maintained and want to make it as easy as possible for that to take place?
Well, the first rule is don't die at all. you know, and if that can't be accomplished, then pretend you're already dead. Put in place all the funding your entity will ever need. Hire the staff to be your assistants who can then seamlessly take care of it all and have clear instructions about what to do. And again, have it all funded ahead of time. Don't rely on the so-called art world to help you out, because in fact, that'll be very rare and very unlikely. So you have to rely on yourself, your work, and your effort to get it done. But it all has to be set up while you're alive. If you leave it to other people to be set up, I mean, it's the chances of it being done correctly are incredibly small. And in a certain way, you know, Don was lucky that we knew what he wanted to be done, because I mean, already we had people that were supposedly close to him, like, trying to get assets for their own. I mean, it would happen within weeks of his death. And that's the norm. And I think any artist's estate will tell you the same. So I think it's pretty clear. And that's where the lawyers and accountants are very useful. Use them when you're alive, because when you're dead, they're not so useful.
You know, I mentioned the Rothkos earlier. I think you can go back and read about exactly what they were faced with, because like you and Rainer, they were barely out of their teens when their father passed, and they hadn't been named as executors, and folks from Marlboro were, and basically there wound up being a lawsuit because it appeared that there was quite a bit of dumping and padding and kickbacking that went into kind of a liquidation sale right after the passing, something that Kate had to fight for to get them reestablished and try to claw back some of the assets. And I guess as an artist, if this is your life's work and you want there to be a legacy, you have to be thoughtful in your lifetime, right?
You have to do it. It's that simple. If you want your work to survive past you, except scattered in, you know, random museums, then you have to do it yourself. And putting together a will doesn't count. That's not doing it. You have to have it actually set up and up and running and funded. Before you die, not after, because these things just don't go together and get put together by themselves. And again, I mean, when Don died, we had nobody we could get advice from. All we had was don't become Rothko. That's all the information we had. There were really very few artist foundations around, none with any kind of real estate like us. And so we had to kind of find solutions as we went along. But I think now with the amount of information that can be found, it's a lot easier. But even then, you should be very skeptical about the way things are done, because the way things are already done in the world are a mediocrity compared to what you can do if you really try to solve things on an individual scale. So you really have to take every problem as its own and find a solution and not generalize these things. And I think that's why it worked, because we didn't generalize and we didn't have a model to look after. We just solved problems as they came along.
Let's talk a little bit about this show that's up at Gagosian at both of their Madison Avenue locations. What can people expect to see? Because it sounds like it's a pretty wide swath and probably is going to allow us to see how your father worked through some ideas and evolved his practice over what is a 25, 26 year period that we see there in the work, right?
Yeah, it's not a very big show, but also there's no overarching theory, right? I mean, I'm not interested in putting shows together that have some kind of concept. It's just, you shouldn't apply concepts to art. You should just go see the art and from that find a concept or two or three or four. So it's put together based on what pieces work with the others and in what way. And it's a good range of both works and times. But of course, for Don, the time was really not important. So for instance, there's a piece in there from 91 that was designed in the early 60s. And he had it made in 91 because he still wanted to see it. And that was really the only criteria, you know, for making a piece. You want to see it. But the whole purpose of the shows is simply that the art can be experienced. That's all. So, and everything else is just a variable.
You know, there's a good amount of color in the show. Maybe opinions are changing, but I think, you know, a lot of times people don't necessarily think of your father as being someone who used a lot of color or, you know, loved color, but that's not necessarily the truth, right? I mean, or maybe it's just the opposite, right?
Oh, no, he absolutely loved color. And I think, you know, if you have a, 10-foot tall violet, anodized violet stack on your wall, I mean, it's almost nothing color-wise that can compete with that thing. It's just amazing. And no, he absolutely loved color. And he invented a whole series of works in the 80s, the painted aluminum pieces, to as a way of playing with color more, because he had rules with the other works that didn't allow him to do that. For instance, he had a rule that the works, like the stacks, could have one material and one color, but they couldn't have two colors. So you don't have a stack, for instance, or two or more. You don't have a stack with anodized red, blue, green, black. You have clear plexiglass and black anodized. So you have a material and you have a color. So he played with that for a very long time, from the early 60s or mid 60s until the early 80s. And then he created a whole new body of work because he wanted to play with color more. So it was very important to him. And I think that what people tend to read about art and accept the narrative that they read and look at it less. And I think what you get out of Don's art that is in fact very playful, very colorful, and it's all about what you could do with color and space if that's what you're interested in.
I think one of the things we battle in each of our lives is bumping up against labels. And somewhere along the way, your father got labeled as a minimalist, which I think in his mind translated as simplistic. He really didn't have any care for that term, did he?
Well, no, it was a term written in a derogatory manner. So none of the people who supposedly were minimalists cared for it, because it's like being called a country bumpkin just because you're from, I don't know, Oklahoma. You're not going to necessarily take kindly to that, because it the term itself indicates an ignorance of the subject being discussed. So who wants to have anything to do with that? And a lot of the critics who employed the term were the ones who actually didn't look at the work. And you can tell from their writing. It's very theoretical and does not really go into the pieces or how they might look or what they're doing in the space. Or they use words wrong, like illusionism. It's minimalism is a term of ignorance, and you know, that's why it's not embraced. It's like, it's basically stupid term.
Right. So Flavin, you're the protector of your father's legacy. How would you define that legacy? You know, in another 20, 30, 40 years, what would you hope people would be saying about Donald Judd?
I don't really deal with that part. I figure in this case, my job is to preserve the works and spaces so that other people can come up with what they think. And I'm not interested in defining it for people or even putting out a roadmap. I think you open the door and people can then discover the works. I guess I don't like the word legacy, but I guess the legacy comes from there. And it's not my job to define the legacy at all. It's my job, and the people, you know, we have 22 or 25 employees at Judd Foundation and 7 board members. And we define our jobs as preserving what Don made. And that's it.
Well, Flavin, I really appreciate your time today. The show is up through July 14th at Gagosian's Madison Avenue locations. Again, I really appreciate your generosity of time and opening up about Donald Judd. That's all the time we have for this week. You've been listening to ArtSense. You can find the show on Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Google Play, Stitcher Radio, Spotify, or your favorite podcast app. If you've enjoyed this podcast, be sure to subscribe. And while you're there, please rate the show and leave a quick review. Your feedback is the key to other folks finding us. And if you'd like to see images related to the conversation, read the transcript, and find other bonus features, you can go to cambia.art and click on the podcast tab. If you'd like to reach out to me, you can email me at craig@cambia.art. Thanks for listening.